Vanakkam, Namaskar, and welcome to yet another episode of my podcast series, The People I Meet. My name is Shruti Vijayakumar Vasant. I'm a radio jockey from Chennai, and on today's episode, I'm going to be introducing to you a powerhouse of talent. Her stint with a reality show shot her into the limelight, and there's been no looking back ever since. I truly, truly believe she is a star in every sense of the word because she has capitalized so many wonderful opportunities that have come her way. She has dabbled with acting, not just the theater or feature film. She's done serials. She's done a lot of interesting short films as well, which has again sort of put her into a league of her own. And Soundarya Balanandakumar is a wonderful singer, a wonderful actor, and more importantly, a really, really, really fun person to hang out with. So it gives me a lot of happiness in a welcoming playback singer Soundarya to my podcast today. Hi Soundarya, how are you?
Hi, Shru. I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. So first off, thank you so much for being a part of my podcast. Yours is a journey that I definitely want, a lot more people to know about in depth and, very personally. So how has it been? How has this journey been for you so far?
It's been amazing. But first of all, I'd like to say that finally, I've always waited for someone to take a podcast like a series and do. So okay. I'm glad someone like you has actually taken it up and doing it. And the kind of people that you bring in are very interesting actually. And so I hope you continue doing this. All the best, Shru.
Thank you. Podcast. Thank you so,
and that
so
is a
much.
Very, very warm welcome.
I meant everything that I said because like I said, I think I've known you for quite a while now and I followed you from your reality show journey, right? And today the sort of person that you have become is a mixture of a lot of different things, right? Probably Soundarya from 5-6 years ago is definitely not the person that you are today, right? There's been a huge growth. Right? And not just, I don't mean just career-wise, but I also mean as a personality. Right? Because I've seen a lot of those things up front and I sort of understand where you come from. And I know it's not been easy. I know that it's not been an easy journey in terms of handling what people say. Because criticism is something that everybody offers very, very easily, right? But they don't realize what sort of hard work goes behind, especially when you come from a media field. So let's just talk a little bit about the beginning. Right? The success that you sort of achieved on the reality show sort of catapulted you into a different league. Right? But with fame also comes a lot of other issues. So how did you sort of handle that as a person?
Okay, basically, the first time I wanted to be a part of it, it was definitely only a very casual try. So, which means I did not have any, I wasn't really passionate about winning the competition or, I did not set goals for myself as to what I want to become out of the competition. I mean, where I want to place myself in the league or something.
Right.
So all of that wasn't there. So the first time, though it was a casual try, something helped. I mean, I don't know. My sincerity was intact though to be a part of it. So that took me to an extent. That helped me to an extent. And obviously, season 3 was one of the toughest possible seasons in Super Singer, and it is the most successful. So, and that went on for like a year and a half, almost a year and a half. Mm. Probably the longest reality show the people would have watched on Tamil television.
Right.
For like a zillion years now. So, and then the second time I wanted to be a part of it, that's when I properly quit my bank job and I took part of it.
Wow.
Part in it. So I was very passionate. The second time I was like, no, we are not taking this like this time.
Right.
So the first time I used to get very emotional every time there was, criticism from the judges. Because see, when as a singer, how we place ourselves or recognize ourselves as a singer or a performer, mostly our audience would have been our family, our friends, a circle. And we would have, the spot would have been on us most of the time.
Right, right.
But then when you compete in a platform like that, you don't even know, you'll have to search for your spot. And finding one is super difficult, right? Because there are a lot of people like that and there are really good ones. Obviously,
correct.
When there's a competition, based on certain criteria, someone is always better than you. So the second time, I had a lot of plans.
Okay.
I'm going to do this, do that. So that helped I think that was the most challenging part for me, being a part of a reality show, because we had no idea how it worked. How it worked with the audience the first time. Second time, I kind of measured it, and the biggest challenge we faced, I mean, the biggest challenge, I can't say it's a challenge. Yeah, kind of a challenge. The biggest challenge we face is the stereotype that happens, because we are a television contestant.
Right.
To make people accept the fact that contestants need not be treated as amateurs is something we had to, you know, try and break for ourselves. I mean, that completely depended on the kind of opportunities that we were given and the kind of expertise that we showed on the job when we took up music full time. That is one of that is still existing. I would say, I mean, not as much as it existed before, but it still does. So I guess that's it.
Right. No, but it is very refreshing to sort of hear that, because, you know, not everybody is very candid and honest about what goes on behind the scenes, especially when you come from the media. There are so many opportunities or so many times where we have to be politically correct, right? Irrespective of what our true feelings are or which side we actually, you know, swing by, we still have to maintain a neutral tone and say the right things, because there is a certain responsibility associated with the place that we come from, right? True. And today you are a true sort of influencer in your own right, because there are so many people who are following you, not just for your Saturday singing, of course, but also for, you know, the kind of things that you talk about. You are very open about everything that happens, and you're very vocal whenever the need arises to talk about something that is important and close to your heart. You still do it, right? So was Soundarya always this person, or did media sort of transform you to the person that you are today?
No, I've always been like that. Whenever I had to talk about, see, media has given me the opportunity to reach out to a lot more people,
right,
who I would want to listen to me.
Mm-hmm.
So when the purpose of having the following was different, but I'm trying to keep a mix of everything, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Put this limelight also in good use as much as I can.
Correct.
So that
correct.
Is it. So talking about things on social media, I'm always vocal. If I feel something is not right, at least to some 10 people, I'll say it is not right.
When
it was more of a personal, So now it is more of basically strangers that we are dealing with. You know? We don't even know who we are talking to. So when it is like that, it gets all the more interesting to get to know, to tell people what exactly is that. What exactly is that is running in your mind about a certain issue or a certain thing, and to get to know their perspective as well. It's introspective as well.
Very interesting. Yeah, because I think, you know, I used to always say this. For me, social media is a very positive place, okay? As much as I've always believed that anything, if you use it in the right manner, whether it's technology, whether it's social media, anything that you take in the right amount, and if you use it for the right purposes, it is going to give you back a stronger community. And that is what we sort of aim to build, right? Right. Amazing. Yeah. All right. So talking about post the, you know, reality show stint, right? I didn't even know that you were working in a bank, dude. I mean, that is like something that is very new to me right now. Like, for me, in my head, I've always imagined you as somebody who's been very passionate about singing and, you know, who's just taken up singing full time. So how did you sort of convince yourself that you wanted to give up that career? Because bank job is something that, you know, people like tavam kadapanga abdin solvanga illaya, like they really work hard to get into that industry. So how did you sort of make that decision?
Because, okay, see, my dad has always wanted to see me as a banker or something to do with, he wanted to actually see me as a chartered accountant. I said, it is definitely not possible in this birth.
Okay.
I said, you please alter your goal based on what I'm capable of.
Right.
So he changed it, of course. Changed it in the sense, see, you know, dads, they like to see daughters in positions.
Right, certain positions
like a bank manager or like an insurance officer, those proper traditional jobs that they want us to take up. I did not want to just reject it just because I was interested in media. And media just happened. Mm. I didn't know Super Singer is going to have such a huge impact in my life. Yeah. So when I was a part of a competition, it was just a competition for me. But the television still had an impact that we were unaware of. I mean, the intensity and the reach and everything. So after that, the kind of opportunities, I mean, I promised my dad that I would take up a proper job after this. That's exactly why he gave me. I had finished all my, I finished my undergrad, grad, postgrad, everything. And then after that, I tried with Super Singer. So I had to keep my promise. After I finished Super Singer, the week I got eliminated, I think I got placed.
Okay.
Yeah, so I went, I got myself placed, and I worked for a private bank with a very good position with an amazing salary. But then the kind of opportunities that came my way after the Super Singer stint, first time. Because of my work commitment, I was forced to say no to a lot of things. For example, I had to say no to at least 3 concerts of Raman sir, which I was supposed to travel for.
Ooh.
So, I mean, things like that. Right. Actually, that's just an example.
Right.
So many things. I mean, I used to try and manage. But obviously, it is different for a full-time musician and a part-time musician. Yeah.
Very true.
Bank is a time-consuming job. And it is not like 9 to 4, none of that. That has become some mystical thing, this 9 to 4 for banks as well. So I had a lot of responsibilities that I found it very difficult to handle in the first place. So then, because I completely realized my heart was definitely not in the bank.
Okay.
So I did not tell my parents about, resigning.
Right.
The second time, the auditions of Super Singer came up.
Okay.
I just took a day off from my work. I went, attended the auditions. The kind of vibe that I got when I attended the first 2-3 sets of auditions. I don't know, some confidence that I went to resent came.
Wow.
Like a week.
Wow.
And my dad and mom didn't know for quite some time that I resented. They still thought I was still working.
Right.
That was the most difficult, dramatic part. They were like, what? What? And I said, actually, 10 days later, 10 days after I attended the auditions, the telecast started. That's when they knew I even went and took part in the auditions.
Right.
They were like, what are you doing in Super Singer 4? Are you a guest or something? I'm like, no, I'm a contestant.
Wow. Oh my God. Okay. So there's a lot of drama in Soundarya's life. I mean, the good
absolutely,
kind of...
Absolutely. Yeah.
Right. Good kind of drama, because that is... What is life without all of that, Ilya? In the Madhuri, these are the moments that sort of make us look back and say, wow, I did that. Of course, we laugh about it.
I'm kind of prone to, making my own decisions. I've always been like that. I'll keep it as a surprise. It will only come as a surprise to family most of the time.
Okay.
It has been like that since I was a kid. I don't know, I had that in me.
Right.
It has developed. Now it has gotten magnified. And I like it.
It's a good thing. As long as you're very happy in the space that you are in, I think that's all that matters.
I mean, decisions will not, they don't harm me. So,
right.
Now that my parents are like, okay, she apparently makes the right decision first. So they don't budge or hover anymore.
Okay. Yeah, that's nice. I think you've sort of proved to them that, this is sort of the place that you are in, and that you're very happy with the sort of, success and the failures that you've had. Because life obviously is not just a bed of roses, and it's especially when you come from the media, it's not always about the highs that we see, right? We always see glitter and the glamour of what goes behind the actual, scenes that we see on television. But there's so much more behind that, right? Okay.
Absolutely.
Right. So, Sound, you were talking about how, all of these opportunities that came, right? I know that after your stint with, I think, season 4, that is how you sort of embarked on this acting career, right?
Yeah.
So, how did that sort of happen? I mean, because I'm sure you've answered this in quite a few interviews, but there obviously would have been like a point where you thought, am I capable of this, right? Because it's a very new sort of dimension for you at that point. So tell me a little bit about how you felt during that time.
Okay, to be very honest, I've never seen acting as a career for myself. Yes, you were right. It's not about capability, but it's about not really wanting to do something like that, because okay. I've never thought of myself as an actor. But I've always, you know, I mean, I'm not as good as my sister, but I've been performing for my mother for Bharatanatyam. So the drama, that acting thing already happens in
right.
a way.
Right.
So it's not like I cannot see myself as an actor, but I didn't want to.
Okay.
I never thought I would see myself. So
right,
there's a difference there.
Mm-hmm.
So when it came my way, it literally came my way. I did not even ask. I have not even expressed to people, I mean, in my Vijay TV family, saying I'm okay to try or something like that. Not
right.
even once.
Mm.
So this just sort of came my way because they were looking for a girl who is bold and, you know, funny and, you know, sometimes loses it all by herself kind of a girl.
Right.
That's how the character was.
Right. Yeah.
I mean,
it's
not as intensely as I think it's not portrayed as intensely as I am telling you right now.
Right.
I mean, that was the criteria that they were looking for. And apparently they were, you know, watching us behave all day
in one
of the Super Singer rounds.
Okay.
I mean, upon the, there was something called mini series that was happening.
Right. Yeah.
So apparently, they were, you know, on the lookout, and the team had to come sit, watch who's who's probably who will fit this criteria of being all
okay.
So then apparently I fit. So they asked, Sandhya, would you like to be a part of a serial? And I did not even know it was a serious proposal. I had the audacity to say, I will not play this hero's sister at all. I'll only play the heroine. Otherwise, don't even try calling me.
I don't want this American Ma play and all. I want to be only hero. Okay.
No. Correct. I said that. I mean, right on their face, they're like, no. You will not do that, Yuma. This is exactly what you want. Please come.
Wow, nice. Okay, so a little bit of a reflection of who you were sort of translated into the role. Okay, interesting.
The role, and then a lot of things change. Serial, you know how they work.
Yeah, that is obviously there.
Changes every month.
That is
one
true,
month I'm in coma. Second month I'm bungee jumping. So, it's that kind of different.
Right.
So that is how acting actually started. But I have to be very honest, I did not have any idea that it was such a challenging job.
Okay.
It is not easy.
Right.
It is not easy to understand what the director asks you to do. It is not easy to translate it into a work. It is not easy to be sincere to the job. It is not. It is very tiring. But at the end of the day, when we learn it, I literally learned it on the job.
Okay.
So, at the end of the day, after an entire day of shoot, and after you watch yourself on TV, and when people come and tell you that it was amazing to watch you perform like that, we didn't know Sandhya could act like this. We didn't know Sandhya could act like that. And I'm like, okay, now we can peacefully go and sleep. So we have made a right decision and all that.
Very nice. I remember the sort of initial impact that you created through that particular series, where the focus shifted entirely to you guys as a couple, as opposed to the lead pair, right?
Both of us were leads.
But I think you guys had a little bit of a favoritism, and a lot of people were enjoying watching you guys perform together. That sort of brings me into the next question that I wanted to ask you, because when you learned it on the job, right, like serials, like you said, are a very different ball game from, like, say, a feature film or acting in theater, right? So after this, you went on to do a little bit of theater. You also went on to do this really successful short film series, which we're also looking forward to seeing. You also released a small part of it this year during the lockdown, right? And then you also, in the meantime, started doing feature films as well. I know you can't talk about your current big project. I'm not going to ask you about that. But just tell me, what is the sort of difference that you see amongst all these mediums?
See, the dedication level is pretty much the same. As far as you know how to handle you, as far as you develop an understanding as to how things work, which is basic. I mean, you can't treat every opportunity the same way. Yeah?
Right.
You need to be prepared. First of all, if we decide to be a part of, I always have followed this. If I decide to be a part of something, I better be sincere. So I've always followed that, and it has always worked only for the right reasons.
Right.
So major difference is the scale. The audience differ. The set of audience differ. So you have to cater to them. So you will have to, you know, the kind of acting that you do in a serial cannot be used in a movie. It needs to be mellowed down a bit, and depends on the kind of understanding that you will have as a performer.
Right.
And it is better to understand it. I mean, people who understand it better fare well.
Right. Okay.
Irrespective of the mediums. Yeah.
Nice. Again, I think acting is something that, like you said, you know, is a very challenging sort of career path to go down, because there are so many expectations, right? Like, I still remember when somebody asked me why I've never sort of, despite coming from a dancer background, why I've never done that, because I've always wondered when I look at heroines, how they cry on the spot. See, laughing is something, okay, if someone cracks a joke, at least you can forever be happy. But imagine having to cry. Imagine having to get yourself into that scene. So, like, I have a lot of respect for people who get into the acting side, because not, like I said, you know, not everybody knows or understands the nuances or how important it is to be restrained when you're doing a certain performance, or how you need to go over the top. There's a very fine line between overacting and actually, you know, playing the part correctly. So, very nicely put, Soundarya. Moving on and talking a little bit about, you know, coming from the media background. Like, today you are a full out and out a media professional, right? So obviously the viewpoint that people have from the outside about a media personality, especially in a sort of conservative / traditionalist society that we come from, how do you sort of understand that? How do you sort of deal with the everyday bookies and the brickbats? How do you sort of balance that? Do you let it affect you?
Okay. I used to let it affect me. Because I'm basically very reactive. I mean, naturally reactive to things. I'm like this.
Right.
Yeah. I react like how a cat does. But it took some time, obviously. It's been, what, 9 years since I started with Super Singer Journey now.
Wow.
So that's quite some time to, you know, understand that.
Right.
The brickbats matter as far as you manage to catch them and keep them aside instead of catching and throwing them back.
Okay.
The right kind of brickbats that don't hurt you, you know. Brickbats that come with a sponge.
Right.
Hits you but molds you. Hits you but, you know, sculpts you. They're good. The brickbats that come just hit you and leave, you know, a wound on you and do nothing but make you look bad, they don't matter. They really don't. Because they do it just for the sake of doing it. So I don't really pay attention to that anymore. That's something that I've learned. And the bouquets are amazing. Obviously, who doesn't love bouquets?
Absolutely. Yeah.
I would love to keep them coming. So as much as they could. I love people coming and telling you. Imagine knowing someone personally and appreciating them. But, you know, completely, you're just a media personality to them.
Right.
You taking their time off to come tell you that they love you so much. See, we have our celebrity crushes as well, or celebrity, the people that we like, actors that we are fond of. But do we take the effort to, you know, go text them or tell them how much we love them?
Right.
Have we done that? Do we do that through?
We don't.
We don't. But imagine, I used to wonder, who are these people? Why are they taking so much time to tell somebody that they love them so much? Just because they're watching us on TV or in some medium.
Right.
That love is, I cannot explain what it can do to you. Ne? It is so beautiful, so pure. They have nothing but only good intentions for you. So that is amazing. I would love to keep them. I want them to keep coming to me. So bouquets are just so... But that doesn't mean you can take the bouquets for granted. You have be responsible.
Yeah.
And... you know, not disappoint them. Not disappoint them in the sense, don't lose their love. Try not to. That's what I'm saying.
I think it's a very mature response that you've given me, Sound. Really, it's very, very beautiful because, you know, usually when we talk about criticism or when we talk about brickbats, right, it's very easy, especially with social media today. You can hide behind a screen and say whatever it is that you want to people, whether it is good, whether it is bad, right? But to be able to understand when a brickbat is constructive, that is very, very important. And I think you put that in such beautiful words. So thank you so much for that. And I'm sure the bouquets are going to keep coming for you through the years to come. So don't worry about it at all. I think the love is just, you know, growing exponentially every single day with every single new, you know, journey that you're embarking upon. So don't worry about that at all. So, you know, talking about all of this, right, makes me want to go back and ask you this question. Sandhya, you just said that, you know, 9 years is not an easy joke, okay, especially after coming from the sort of background that you come from. You know, I'm thinking that you're the first person from the media, I mean, first person into the media from your family, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, so it's something that is, you know, not very easily accepted by family. Trust me, I know how that feeling is. So how did your parents sort of help you make that transition? Because I know that not everybody has the nicest things to say about media professionals. So how did your parents sort of accept that and sort of give you that, you know, emotional strength or the moral support to keep doing this every single day?
Okay, that's a brilliant question. I've always wanted to explain how the process happened to somebody. Finally, his perspective has been questioned. So yeah, the thing is, the most important thing, being a girl, see, we can say we are independent, we're bold, but at the end of the day, we have to face our issues. Mm. We have issues that we cannot escape.
Correct. Right.
So, to be able to face that with some confidence, I had to gain my parents' trust. You know, I wanted them to trust me that I will not, you know, lose my vision or, you know, do things that I'm not supposed to do just because I'm in the media. I mean, the independence, the influence, the distractions, everything, they're just going to be there. That happens to, if you look at it, it happens to anybody.
Right.
Okay. We also are exposed to the same kind of distractions. Mm. But when it is media, it is a wee bit exaggerated at some point.
Very true.
Where they think we naturally get distracted like that. Mm. But we don't. So, I had to step out of the house, position myself in a city that I'm not very used to. I mean, I did my college year, but then, you know, I was under the supervision of my grandparents. But then to have a separate place and, you know, to get used to things.
Mm.
I earned my father's and mother's trust. That was the most important thing that I wanted. They deserve it. Yeah? To be able to, if you want your goals to be supported, then you better be responsible. I mean, you can't expect your parents to, you know, just be supportive if you're going to fool around and do things that you're not supposed to do when you're supposed to concentrate on your work, which you're supposed to be passionate about. I mean, I don't understand where the irresponsibility comes from. If you're very passionate, you will not have time to be irresponsible.
True.
You very won't true. Have the time. So as much as I enjoy the time that I'm alone or independent, I feel very responsible about myself, and I used to feel exactly the same. Apdida, 9 years back, as every responsibility I felt, it's the same now. There is no change.
Right.
So that has helped my parents. They were like, this woman will take care of herself. And after a point, they were like, this girl will take care of herself. Because I used to run and take all my opportunities, sleepless nights. I used to work in the bank, take shows up in the night, travel, come back. So to position myself, it has taken quite some time. I mean, it has taken a lot of effort.
Right.
Not meaningless, absolutely meaningful effort, which transforms into, you know, trust, happiness, satisfaction and stuff like that on the job. So that has helped. My family finally, after a point, they were like, this girl will really, you know, take care of herself, and they had to gain the confidence. I had to give them the confidence. That was a process which I sincerely did, and I gained it. That's all.
beautiful sound, really. I think you know, I like the way how you mentioned, if we want something, we need to be able to give our parents the feeling of trust, right? I think that is very, very important, yes. Because at the end of the day, they are the reason who we are today, right? As much as we want to say that, you know, we're independent, we can take care of ourselves, we still are sort of indebted to our parents forever, because they are the reason why we are the people that we are today. And they have given so much up. They have made so many sacrifices to get us to this point. And the least we can do is be responsible adults. And I think that's a very beautiful lesson to anybody who's listening today and is sort of thinking about, hey, why are my parents doing this? Because this is something that I talk to a lot of people about, you know. I ask them, so how do you, you know, convince your parents? Because a lot of us, right, have had to make that convincing happen. We've had to tell them time and again, you know what, don't worry about us. Because I'm sure, you know, you've also, like you said, you know, a lot of late night, a lot of traveling, a lot of going to unknown places, a lot of, you know, where are we going to be staying? Like, because at the end of the day, parents want our safety to be the first priority, right?
Safety and security is what they're worried about.
Exactly. And given the sort of, you know, industry that we come from and all the sort of, you know, irregular timings and everything. And you can't say no to an opportunity when it comes, right? If Harris Gerard sir is recording a song at this time, you can't say no, I can't go. If it comes, you pick it up and you go to the studio, irrespective of how long it takes you to get there. Beautiful, sir. Very, very, very nice. And it's so nice to see that you've got this very bold vision of what you want for yourself and how clear and communicative you are about that. So I think that's a very beautiful lesson for everybody who's listening to sort of take away. And sort of wrapping up this conversation, sound. So you've delved into singing and you've enjoyed your stint in playback. You've had a lot of amazing concerts. You've worked with A.R. Rahman, sir. You've worked with a lot of the top leading music composers and the who's who of the industry. And simultaneously, you've also gone into the acting realm and you're doing a lot of amazing projects right now. And you've also created this very comfortable yet very nice community for yourself on social media. Right? So 9 years back, when you started on this journey, what was your thought? What did you think of? And today, what are you thinking of going forward? Just to do a sort of comparison between the past and the
present. Oh, okay. I first of all, honestly, don't remember what I was thinking. To be very honest. 9 years is quite some time ago.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I mean, jokes apart. See, that's what I'm saying. I did not have set goals because I did not want to disappoint myself.
Right, right.
I wanted to just do what I'm supposed to do. For example, if there is one round of Super Singer happening today, I just wanted to farewell in that particular one day at a time has always been my move.
Right, right.
And it has worked for me. Let's take up one day at a time. Let's not get too futuristic because we don't know what comes our way and we need to be able to, you know, face the changes or, you know, or troubles. I don't like to use the word, but troubles. But instead, I think I kind of concentrated on accepting what we get in the first place. I mean, get disappointed, it's okay. But do not let the disappointment affect your quality of work.
Right.
Or anything. That is pretty much in our control. And that's what I've tried to do. And sincerity goes a long way. Be sincere as possible so that puts a smile on your face. Sincerity is very personal.
Right.
I mean, you do not have to prove your sincerity to somebody else. If you are sincere to yourself, it will automatically show.
Very true.
So that is there. So, I mean, showing up right on time for work or small things like that. You know, if a show is at 10 o'clock, I want to be there by 9:45. I've gotten mocked for that.
Right.
Like, why is she always on time? I'm like, then I got respected for that after a point. Soundria is in the show. We can't afford to go late. That's how it got changed.
Nice.
And things like that happen, you know. So compared to what I wanted to do back then and what I wanted to do now, it's pretty much the same. As in, only the intensity of work life has changed. I mean, it's with a magnifying glass. It's become a slightly bigger circle and stuff like that. But apart from that, the things that I want to do, the way I want to approach my opportunities are just the same. இப்போ கொஞ்சம் கான்ஃபிடன்ஸ் கொஞ்சம் ஆப்வியஸ்லி கொஞ்சம் பெட்டர்
ரைட்
because you've gained a lot of introspection and gained a lot of perspective as well. So that's going to help us, help me pretty much the same, one day at a time, Yashiro. That's it.
Beautiful. Yeah, I think a lot of us sort of, you know, we get so warped in this idea of success, because I've always said this, success is something that's very, very subjective. Okay. What success means to you may not necessarily mean success to me. Right. I've always said this to a lot of people. We all aim to be, you know, billionaires. We all aim to have this fancy car. We all aim for so many different things in life. Again, the wants and wishes are very, very subjective to different people. But at the end of the day, are we choosing to be happy? I think that is something that is so, 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 so important, right? Are we doing work that satisfies our soul? Are we being competent? Are we doing the, you know, our jobs with integrity? And anything for that matter, are we living a life full of integrity? I think that is what it ultimately comes down to. And a lot of people view success very differently, but to each his own, right? And taking it one day at a time sort of puts things into perspective for us, because this COVID-19 situation has also taught us that. Right? I mean, you never know what the future holds. So there's no point in thinking, oh, by 2020, you know, I'm going to be doing this. Whereas this year itself has sort of put a hold on so many different things for all of us. So just sort of, this will probably be my last question. 2020 as a year, right, has taught us a lot of things, has sort of, you know, made us introspect and understand where we come from and what it is sort of like to live in a world like this, right, where there's a lot of uncertainty, there's a lot of gloom, there's a lot of, okay, let's see what else 2020 has to bring. We're all looking forward to this year to end. But what has Soundarya's personal growth sort of been like in this particular year?
Ah, okay. 2020, first of all, gave me a lot of time. I do not want to say I enjoyed this time. I will never say that, because it wasn't enjoyable for the majority of the people. I mean, for us, for everybody, we had our own troubles and, you know, challenges to face during this time. But I got to spend some solid amount of time with my parents. It's been 7 years since I spent so much time with them.
Right.
So, like 4 months with them was, I would have never thought of doing that.
Right.
So that is a blessing in disguise.
Mm-hmm.
My food habits were influenced properly in the right way.
Right.
I kind of started working out, which I thought I never would. And I'm apparently enjoying it, which again is super surprising.
Right,
because
right.
I've always been this lean, thin girl.
Right.
So I've always had the confidence to say, fitness, I don't want.
Okay.
But then it is very, very vital.
Okay.
To, you know, have some amount of fitness happening in your life. So that is a major change that happened to me during this lockdown. I picked a routine.
Okay.
So, and I'm generally sincere to my routine. So, as of now, I am.
Okay.
That is there.
Right.
Yeah, that is a major change that happened on a lighter note.
Right.
On a heavier note, we need to chill, calm in life. Yeah. I mean, we need to just accept what we have.
Right.
And just make it better. There is nothing much you can do. If things go out of control, that is it. You just have to face. Nature gives you no choice but to listen to it. At one point.
What a transformative year this has been for all of us.
Right? Absolutely.
Very, very, philosophically, very nicely put.
Physically, mentally.
Yeah, I think a lot of people have embarked on these journeys this year where they've done a little bit of soul searching, where they've understood, you know, where they come from, and that it's absolutely okay to not be a part of a rat race all the time and sort of put yourself as a priority.
Exactly. Correct. Correct. Right?
Because it's okay
to not keep wanting stuff. You can very much be happy with what you have.
Very, 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 very true. And on that note, I think it's a beautiful way to sort of wrap up this conversation that I've had with you. It's truly been very, very refreshing, Sounda, because this is a side of you. Of course, we always, whenever we meet up for a concert or whenever we meet up for an event or anything, we're always talking about all the good things, right? We're always talking about, hey, how is life going, work, and, you know, we talk about all of that. But this has really put a lot of different ideologies into my head about the sort of person that you are. And I think that is exactly what the whole point of my podcast is, you know, knowing the person rather than the personality. So as a winding up, right, what is it that you would like to share with the people who are listening right now?
I think these podcasts are I find them very organic. First of all, they're really nice. I mean, to talk about stuff that you don't generally talk about on a daily basis, it's nice. And podcasts take me to the time when radio was, you know, super active. And
right,
there used to be interviews like these. I mean, now everything has become time bound. And
very true.
We don't even get to people talk for so long in a radio interview. And we do not have the patience to sit and listen to people talk. Podcasts are important. Yeah? I mean, you will gain the ability to sit and listen to somebody, which we're supposed to do in everyday life.
Right.
So I think podcasts are beautiful. I'm a big fan because I follow a lot of Hollywood podcasts.
Right, right.
The movie, not the movie thing, but a lot of actors from the series that we watch, they all have their own podcast channels. So I do listen to a lot of stuff. So, which is nice, Shro. I really think you should never stop doing them.
Definitely.
Something if you want to. But don't stop your podcast. They're beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you. There are going to be so many more stories to share. And I think that is the sort of aim that I have, because I love listening to stories. Okay. And I love to talk, which is something that everybody knows. So, and I want to share as many stories to the world as possible, because stories like yours are so beautiful, are so inspirational, and they're so motivating on those days when you feel like nothing is going right. And you just sort of want to listen to people making sense. I think that's a very beautiful thing. You know, that's very, very beautiful. That's very important as well in today's day and age, because we're surrounded by so many things, right? Taking the right thing, I think that is very, very important. So once again, thank you so much, Soundarya, for being a part of my podcast today and for sharing your incredible journey with me. It's been an absolute pleasure.
So glad I was a part of it. Thank you so much for having me on your podcast episode.
Thank you. And on that note, we come to the end of today's episode. You can follow Soundarya Balanandakumar on all her social media platforms. She's very active and is very vocal about everything that she feels, says, and she sings like a dream. She's also going to be featuring in a very, very, very big film. You're going to be seeing her very soon as well. So all of those updates and more, you can follow her, like I said, on her social media handles. With that, we come to the end. I will catch you with yet another interesting personality and yet another interesting story on yet another interesting episode of my podcast series, The People I Meet. My name is Shruti Vijay Kumar Vasant, a radio jockey from Chennai, and it's time for me to say ta-da, bye-bye, take care, see you, and thank you for tuning in. See you on the next episode. Bye-bye.